Well, good morning, church. So good to see you today. Come on in and find your place today. Welcome. Welcome to the house of the Lord. So good to hear the people of God stirring around, getting ready to worship. Amen.
Amen.
Page 97.
Well, we want to welcome you today. Welcome to Cherry Grove Baptist Church, where the unconditional love of Jesus Christ is preached and practiced to the glory of God. We want you to be at home here. We want you to enjoy the service, the worship of God, the people of God. And we pray you come back real soon. We'd like to get to know you, to be friends with you. One thing in this service we'd like to do is get some information from you. We'll give you an ink pen in return. Our contact information is on that ink pen. If you ever need us, please feel free to give us a call. Any guests with us today, please raise your hand. Any guests with us today? Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. Right down front here. Brother Deacons, any others? Excuse me. Glad to have you today. Right on the very first pew over here. Brave souls right here. All right. We're glad to have you today. Church, I want to say to you first off, thank you so much for your prayer. My family and I, as we went on vacation to Mexico, had a wonderful time. And your prayers mean everything to us. They protected us, strengthened us, and enabled us to do what God wanted us to do, what we enjoyed doing. So thank you. We're back safe. Sam, how does it work today? She had to catch up on some things. Well, we'd be able to do that. So, praise the Lord for that. I'm glad to be back. And thank you so much for your prayers. God answers prayers. Amen. Aren't you glad?
Amen.
Yes. Amen. Let me give you a few announcements this morning. There's a lot going on in our church, and you're going to miss out if you're not keeping up, okay? Your bulletin's got a lot of things there listed. On the overhead, there'll be many things going on. First of all, the Lamar Camp meeting. It is here. It's already here. What an opportunity that we have as God's people during this camp meeting. It's exciting. Had a wonderful prayer time this past Saturday down at Lamar at 8:30, and it was so enjoyable. And we want to just pray and seek the Lord and support this in every way we can. So this coming week, Monday through Friday, we want you to be there. I'm curious, if you already plan to be there, raise your hand. Okay, got some of you, maybe, I don't know. Well, I hope after the message today I'll persuade you to come on and be a part of that. Wednesday night service here at the church is canceled. So if you come here, there'll be a sign on the door that says, go to the camp meeting. Go to the camp meeting. So be there. It's going to be wonderful every night. Do you realize how many prayers have went up for this camp meeting? How many prayers that God would visit us in a fresh touch from heaven? We're going to see souls saved. We're going to see families put back together, people getting right with God. And church, that's what it's about. That's what it's about. So we're excited about that for this opportunity. New men's class is going to start. Yeah, new men's class for our college men. Hallelujah. Our young men. 6 o'clock downstairs in the college room is going to be coming in the future, the near future. You'll hear more about that. I'll tell you what, if I had a son in church, if I had a son present in the community, I would want to get him in this material. That's how good it is. That's how good it is. I would want my son to grow up with the proper teaching about manhood. So I pray that parents, you get behind your pastor in that. I'll be leading that class, and I'm excited about it. Scott's fully on board. Others are going through the material. They're saying every man needs to be in this material. So you'll be hearing more. You'll have an opportunity to sign up for that. Replicate. I hear there's a new group started. Is there a new group started? If you're a new group, raise your hand. Claudia, you're part of that group too, aren't you? Who else is part of that group? That's a discipleship group that is a very proven way to develop as a child of God. So don't forget that. God is good?
All the time.
All the time. All the time, God is good. Let's see. Have I forgotten anything? Is there a video? Y'all got a video. We got a video. Listen.
No one. There is no one else. Kansas City, and she's the daughter of Jim and Patty Rowland, and she was here to celebrate Jim's 70th birthday. So happy birthday, Jim.
Thank you for announcing it to the church.
But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace you are saved. And hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus.
Amen.
For by grace are you saved through faith, and not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast.
Amen.
For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. This morning, the choir is going to be singing Your Love Awakens Me with Get All Excited.
Jesus Christ is still the King of
My Savior, more than All God's people said, amen. Hallelujah. I tell you, there's a lot of people praying for revival, not only in our church, but throughout the land and other countries. And we need revival. We need husbands to get revived, wives to get revived, families to get revived, the church to get revived. Amen? We had a big old group of ladies go down to Woodstock for a women's conference. If you went to that conference, stand up. Amen. Got several of you here. Good, good, good. All right, thank you. Please be seated. Well, tell us about it. What did God do in your hearts? You went down there and worshiped and had a great time together. Tell us about it.
The speakers each had something that they had been struggling with. And some had struggled with divorce and adultery. Some had struggled with a spouse that had been sick. Or the second lady, actually, her husband had developed Alzheimer's. And she was just talking about their journey and where God had brought her from, because she was saved at the age of 8, but she had lived a life that was not what God had intended for her, and she had gone through a lot of things that were not what he had in store. So she gave her life completely to the Lord, and she was married, and they had a wonderful relationship, and then her husband developed Alzheimer's. So she had to struggle with the decision of what to do for his care. Then the last lady who spoke was talking about grief, and that's something that I have dealt with. But her husband passed away when she was 25 years old and left her with 3 children under the age of 3, one of which was a newborn. And all of the, through the whole weekend, everyone was talking about the struggles that they've had, and that even though we have struggles, God is still in control.
That's
He's
right.
Still working through all of those struggles. And though we can't see when we're walking through the valley, we can be assured that what's on the other side is so much more than what we think that we've lost. And that His great mercy and love is there ready to forgive us whenever we have messed up so bad. And He's full of mercy, and He's full of justice and righteousness. And it was just an amazing weekend, and we had a lot of fun with the ladies, and just getting to spend time together and just fellowship and get to get away from life and just be under the Word.
Amen.
It was amazing. And I think my mother wants to say
something. This weekend was really a blessing to me. As we listened to the speakers and what they talked about. But the one that talked about the last one where she talked about losing her husband, that touched my heart. And all three of those ladies talked about the place we get our strength to get through all of these struggles and everything is from God's Word. And the whole time they were quoting Scripture and telling us you need to be in the Word every day. And that's something that I tell the ladies in my Sunday school class, no matter what you're going through, if you get in God's Word, He will speak to your heart and He'll help you get through it. And it was just a blessing to me, and I just, I was thankful I got to go, and I just thank the Lord for saving me and for hearing other people that are going through trials like we're going through every day, because all of us are going through something. And one of the things they mentioned was every one of us have a story. And God gave us that story to tell somebody else and to encourage them. And that's what He calls us to do.
Amen. Thank you, Kathy. Anybody else? Anybody else? Raise your hand. Come on, tell us what God did in your life. Now, if you don't, I'm going to preach. Anybody else going once? Twice? Take your Bibles, turn to John chapter 17. John 17, praying like Jesus. We have here in this chapter the high priestly prayer of the Lord Jesus Christ. And you know, there's references in the Bible several times about Jesus praying. And a lot of those references are simply this, that he went off to a solitary place and prayed. And it doesn't give us the content. It doesn't elaborate. It doesn't say, what did he say? You know, it doesn't get into it. But John 17 gets into it. And it tells us what he prayed. And it tells us the conversation that he had with his Father. And this is holy ground, church. John 17 is the high priestly prayer of Jesus Christ. And we can glean so much from this chapter in the Bible. We glean from it an intimate relationship with Jesus and his Father. And likewise, God wants us to have that intimacy with God as our Father as well. From this chapter, John 17, we glean from it Jesus' values. You know, what you pray about is what you value. And Jesus brings up one subject after another, things that are dear to his heart, dear to his soul, that he brings up and talks to his Father about. So we can see that. His values should be our values. We are exposed to the passion of the Lord in this passage. And he has a passion on his heart. And that is to go to the cross and die for the sins of all humanity. He was not passive. He took responsibility and stepped forth and prayed that the Father would bring it on into his life. The hour, the cross, the suffering, the shedding of blood, the crucifixion. That people could be saved, that people could be united back to God. This John 17 has so many other things, so I pray that you would be attentive this morning as we look at this chapter and glean from it. We'll come back to it tonight and in other sessions as well, other times as well, because it's so rich. It's the prayer life of Jesus being exposed. You know, we can learn a lot here about our own prayer life, what we need to be praying about. Amen? Because God runs the world on prayer. Prayer starts with him. He brings it down and puts a prayer on your soul. He touches you. You desire to pray. You go off to pray. You bring things back up to him. And then it makes full circle. God runs the world on prayer. Notice in your Bible, John 17, verses 1 through 5. Let's look at it, then we'll begin to expound it and look at it together. These words spake Jesus. Now he's talking about John 13, 14, 15, the intimate dialogue that Jesus had with his disciples previously and things he talked about. Then it says, he lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour is come. I want you to think about this, church. He wasn't passive. He didn't sit around waiting on the cross. He stepped forth and prayed that the cross would come on into his life. Because he knew he was destined. He knew his purpose was to die on that cross for the sins of the world. So he took full responsibility, full engagement of God's will. And we should too approach life that way, taking full responsibility for what he has for us. Bible says here that he lifted up his eyes and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee. Verse 2, as thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life. Give what? Eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. Verse 3, and this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. I have glorified thee on the earth, and I have finished the work which thou givest me to do. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. What a prayer. What a prayer. Jesus prays. Praying like Jesus, that should be the burning desire and passion of our heart. Because as we pray like Jesus, we become like Jesus. As we pray like Jesus, we begin to see His desires. We should have desires like Jesus. You can't have the desires of Jesus unless you pray like Jesus. Desire like Jesus. And ultimately begin to act like Jesus and pursue the priorities and values of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? When's the last time you thought to yourself or prayed, I want to be like Jesus. I want to be like Jesus. I pray that that's a prayer on your heart, my heart, and all Christians' heart all the time. Because it's God's central purpose for His children, that we be like Jesus. And a key to developing that, a key for that happening in your life, in my life, is to pray like Jesus. I want you to notice the first thing Jesus does here in verses 1 through 5, He prays for Himself. He prays for Himself. Should you pray for yourself? Oh, yes. Yes. Should it go beyond that? Yes. But we should pray for ourselves. Now I want you to see here in this passage what Jesus is praying for Himself. Look in verse 1. The Bible says here, Father, the hour has come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee. Here Jesus is talking about the hour. And in the hour He would be glorified. In His death He would be glorified. And He's asking that He be glorified, not an end in itself, but that He be glorified, that His Father would be glorified as a result. You've got to understand, we've got to understand, the life of Jesus Christ was a life lived for others. And here's what God wants you to be, child of God, a life lived for others. It's not about you. It's not about your family. It's not about your children, your grandchildren. Praise God for them. They're gifts of the Lord. It's not about us. It's not about this church. It's about God. It's about God's glory. And here Jesus prays, bring the hour, that the hour may glorify me, that I may glorify you. It was about the Father's glory. Let me ask you this morning, who are you living for? Whose glory are you living for? Yours? The Bible tells us again and again and again, we were created for God. We were created for God and redeemed for God to live for the glory of God. And all of life is about living for the glory of God. Jesus prays for Himself and He prays about this hour. And He says, Father, the hour has come. Didn't the Father know the hour had come? Why, of course. He uses this word, Father. Father, such an intimate word. We too can use that word, amen? As people that have been bought by the blood of the Lamb, that have made a confession, I want Jesus, I want Him to forgive me, and that has taken place, we too call Him Father. And if that's never taken place in your life, you need to do that this morning. You need to do that this morning before it's everlasting too late. Right now in this service, that you may come to have your peace with the Lord Jesus Christ and God Almighty, and that you may have eternal life. Here he says, the hour has come. Let's think about this hour. You see, God's will was agreed upon. God's will was planned. In the triune God, it was purposed in total harmony and oneness and in love. Let's look at some passages. Jesus, this is not the only time Jesus talks about the hour. This is not the only time that Jesus talks about his death. This is not the only time that Jesus talks about his crucifixion. He mentions it a lot. He knows he's destined for the cross. He's not running from it. He's not a coward. He is leading courageously as the Son of God. Notice first of all in John 2:4, here we see the story of Jesus attending a wedding. He attends this wedding, and in weddings, something has went wrong. And I don't know about you, but things happen like that sometimes in weddings. And the Bible says, Jesus saith unto her, his mother, woman, what have I to do with thee? Mine hour is not yet come. Well, what has she requested? They ran out of wine, and she's turning to Jesus and saying, hey, fix this. It was a big embarrassment. You never want this thing to take place in a wedding. And the mother simply turns to Jesus, Jesus, take care of this. And Jesus brings up this subject. Mine hour is not yet come. Mine hour. I praise God. I don't have to have that hour. And you don't have to have that hour. He took that hour. He shed his blood. He went through that hour. For you and me, do we have struggles and sufferings and things go on in our life? Yes. But this hour nobody will ever take because Jesus took this hour. He died on that cross for the sins of the whole world. And here he mentions this hour. Well, think with me about this hour. What kind of hour was this? This was an hour that was his. Notice your Bible. Mine hour. It was an hour that he would take himself sacrificially. It was a substitutionary death, a substitute death for another. He was not paying for his own sins. He was paying for my sins, your disobedience, the whole world's disobedience. It was a sacrificial hour. It was a separational hour as well. When Jesus went to that cross, when he died on the cross, watch this, the first time in history, he was separated from his Father. The first time, it was a separation between him and his Father that had never happened before. Why? Because of you, because of me, because of the world's sins, that we could come together and be united in eternal life with Jesus Christ. It was not only a sacrificial hour, a separational hour, it was a suffering hour. Kid you not, look at your Gospels. Jesus suffered more than anybody could ever suffer on the face of the earth. He suffered mentally, sociably, physically. He suffered as much as anybody could ever suffer, and he was triumphant and victorious in it. Turn your Bible to John 7:30. Here again he mentions this hour, this death, this crucifixion of his. John 7:30 says, then they sought to take him. Take who? Take Jesus, these religious leaders, but no man laid hands on him because his what? His hour, beloved, was not yet come. His hour was controlled by God. His hour was unchangeable. His hour was untouchable. His hour was forever settled in the triune God. They couldn't take him. They couldn't push it ahead. They couldn't make it happen because it was predestined for a particular time on the clock of the sovereign God of the universe that Jesus should die. It was a unchangeable hour. I'm grateful it was an unchangeable hour. Well, let me give you another deal, Jesus. Well, you know, there's something going on down here. You might be interested in doing that or going to that. No, it was an unchangeable hour. Take your Bibles, look in John chapter 8, verse 12 through 36 as well. It was an undeniable testimony of Jesus' death and purpose in his life. John is so full of the subject about the hour. The hour of Jesus. John chapter 8 in verse 12 through 36. Notice what it says. Then spake Jesus again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. Amen. Verse 13. The Pharisees therefore said unto him, Thou bearest record of thyself. Thy record is not true. Jesus answered and said unto them, Though I bear record of myself, yet my record is true, for I know whence I came and whither I go, but ye cannot tell whence I come and whither I go. Verse 15, ye judge after the flesh. I judge no man. Verse 16, and yet if I judge, my judgment is true, for I am not alone, but I am the Father that sent me. It is also written in your law that the testimony of two men is true. I am one that bear witness of myself, and the Father that sent me beareth witness of me. Verse 19. Then said they unto him, Where is thy Father? Jesus answered, Ye neither know me nor my Father. If ye had known me, ye should have known my Father also. These words spake Jesus in the treasury as he taught in the temple, and no man laid a hand on him for his hour had not yet come. Verse 21. Then said Jesus again unto them, I go my way, and ye shall seek me, and shall die in your sin. Whether I go, ye cannot come. Then said the Jews, What will he kill himself? Boy, they was way off target, wasn't they? Because he saith, Whether I go, ye cannot come. And he said unto them, Ye are from beneath, I am from above. Ye are of this world, I am not of this world. Verse 24. I said therefore unto you that ye shall die in your sins, for if ye believe not that I am he, ye shall die in your sins. Then said they unto him, Who art thou? It's probably a good time to bring that up, amen? Who art thou? And Jesus said unto them, Even the same that I said unto you from the beginning. Verse 26. I have many things to say and to judge of you, but he that sent me is true, and I speak of the world those things which I have heard of him, my Father. Verse 27, they understood not that he spake to them of the Father. Verse 28, then said Jesus unto them, When ye have lifted up the Son of Man, then shall ye know that I am he, and that I do nothing of myself. But as my Father hath taught me, I speak these things. And he that sent me is with me. The Father hath not left me alone, for I do always those things that please him. He spake these things, he spake these words. Many believed on him. You need to believe on him today. Then said Jesus to the Jews which believe on him, if ye continue in my word, then you are my disciples indeed. Verse 32, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Verse 33. They answered him, we be Abraham's seed, and were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free? They missed it. They missed it. Jesus speaks of his hire. Jesus speaks of his dying. Jesus speaks of believing in him and having eternal life. This is the reason he's wanting the hour to come. This is the reason he's asking the Father to glorify him, that he may glorify the Father and offer eternal life for the whole world. The eternal life that many of you possess right now. Aren't you glad? Aren't you happy for the life of God in you right now? Hallelujah! The prayer life of Jesus, praying like Jesus. Turn your Bible to John chapter 12, verse 20 and through 33. Here Jesus predicts his crucifixion, the hour, his life-giving results as well. His whole heart, his whole mind was wrapped up in this hour. And there were certain Greeks among them that came up to worship at the feast. And same came therefore to Philip, which was a Bethsaida of Galilee, and desired him, saying, Sir, we would see Jesus. Philip cometh and telleth Andrew, and again Andrew and Philip tell Jesus. And Jesus answered them, saying, the hour is come. My friend, he didn't run from the hour. He was the perfect man. He faced the hour. He accepted the responsibility. He went forth with the responsibility that the Son of Man should be glorified. Verse 24, truly, truly, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall unto the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. Verse 25, he that loveth his life shall lose it, and he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto eternal life. Notice, if any man serve me, let him follow me, and where I am, there shall also my servant be. If any man serve me, him will my Father honor. Now is my soul troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this cause came I into this hour. Unto this hour. Father, glorify thy name. Then came there a voice from heaven saying, I have both glorified it and will glorify it again. The people therefore that stood by heard it said that it had thundered. Others said an angel spake to him. Jesus answered and said, this voice came not because of me, but for your sakes. Now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out. And if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me. Hallelujah to Jesus. This he said, signifying what death he should die. The hour. He prays for himself. Watch this, watch this. He prays for himself. I like a new car. You know, I like a vacation. I like this. He prays for his death. For you. Isn't he glorious? Isn't he precious? Don't you want to love him more? See, we draw near to today. We draw near to God, and God draws near to us because we begin to possess a knowledge in John 17, 1 about the prayer life of Jesus. He prayed for himself. He prayed that the hour would come, that he would be glorified, and in same sentence that the Father would be glorified, that would be able to offer eternal life. People need the Lord. People need Jesus. We have an opportunity to share Jesus, to bring them to the crusade that's coming up. Amen? Bring them to the old-fashioned tent revival that's coming up. I was reading this week in the Baptist Reflector, your Baptist Reflector, our Baptist Reflector, of a revival that took place. I pray to God that the same thing, even more, would take place in the camp meeting this coming week. We need to bring people to this revival. Monday, we need to bring people to this revival. Oh, Brother Tommy, I'm going to be out of town on Monday. Tuesday, we need to be bringing people to this revival. Take in your mind and draw a circle. And do you have any lost people in that circle? In your family? In your neighborhood? Your sons and daughters? Your grandchildren? Oh, Brother Tommy, I've got other arrangements on Tuesday. It's okay. Wednesday, bring people to the revival. Wednesday. Be a good day, amen? Oh, Brother Tommy, I'm committed on that day. I've got a commitment. That's okay. Thursday, bring people to the revival. Amen? See what an opportunity we got up on us. Friday, bring people. Don't let this opportunity go by. We got to get people under the preaching of the Word, that they'd get saved, that they'd get this eternal life that Jesus died for, that get this eternal life that Jesus prayed would come on into his life. It would glorify him. Pastor Dean Hahn of First Baptist Church, Morristown, talks about forming a committee and serving on a committee about bringing a crusade to an area. And he told the committee, this is either going to be like we're in a big sailboat and God is going to breathe on this and we're going to just glide on through, or it's going to be like an old 1935 Ford truck with the clutch going out and we're grinding the gears. By the time the crusade came to a close on the night of May the 1st. Now this is in, where is it at? Oh, it comes on down in here, excuse me. It was clear that which way it would turn out. This was definitely not an old Ford truck with a clutch going out. The four-day crusade led by evangelist Rick Gage and held at the Walter State Community College, Great Smoky Mountains Expo Center in White Plain, resulted in more than 850 decisions, including 341 professions of faith, and effects are continuing, say continuing, continuing with more salvation in days that have followed. The crusade drew large crowds each night with an estimated total attendance of 17,500. The crowd on Sunday, the opening night, was an estimated 5,000. And the final night of the crusade, which featured a youth emphasis, drew an estimated 6,000, including roughly 3,000 students. God has put an opportunity in our hands. What are you going to do about it? Are you just going to keep on going like usual? or you're going to get serious and do what we're supposed to do, call people, be continuing to pray, and even go pick them up if necessary. Amen? Jesus prayed about this. Jesus died for eternal life. Let's cooperate with Jesus. And let's see our sons and daughters, our grandchildren, our neighbors, our co-workers come to Jesus Christ before it's everlasting too late. Amen? Let's all stand.